shotgun wounds earlier today in his North London studios. Meek, 37, had a string of hits in the early 60s, including Johnny Remember Me and Have I the Right? But it was Telstar, his own composition, for which he will best be remembered. No one else is being sought in connection with the killer.
Hello everyone, my name's Joe Meek. In the next hour, I'm going to bring you some of the things that I've been doing in the last 2 years. It may not interest you all that much, but I can assure you it's very interesting. For instance, have you ever met Marlene Dietrich or Johnny Ray or Norman Wisdom? Well, I have. It's rather a long story, but in this hour, I'm trying to bring you some of the most interesting points and try to describe some of the things that I've been doing.
Tonight, Arena tells the story of one of the most curious characters in the history of British popular music, Joe Meek, the man who claimed to paint pictures in sound. Hitmaker to Britain's first generation of homegrown pop stars, he was an outsider who single-handedly challenged the supremacy of the established recording industry. He felt he had a destiny, that he was the man who was going to invent a new sound for a new era.
Dear Mum, well, lots of things have happened since my last letter. First, the boy I put on Decca Records was in last week's Daily Mirror. Now, here's the nice bit. He was so grateful, he has given me 5% of all his record royalties for 2 years. So, all I can say is it pays to be kind and help others as much as you can. Some let you down, but you are rewarded in the end. I have over 50 songs, all written by myself, and I will release them when I feel the time is right. I'm sure your son is going to be famous one day, Mum. As things are going good, I am very well known in the whole record world. So all the best with everything from your loving son, Joe.
Well, Joe was pantomime mad. You know, he'd get them all up the shed and have a little pantomime. He'd buy clothes and that, wouldn't he, Joe?
Well, yeah, he did. And he used to have a shed up the top of the garden. And they used to put on their own little shows up there from when he was a little boy. And have all the his friends and that in and dress them all up as different characters, and they did put on a little play and charge the locals to come in and watch the play.
And what did the locals think?
They loved it. Some of the comments weren't too...
Why, what sort of comments did they...
well, some of the rougher type of boys like ourselves went
and watched it, and we didn't think too much of it.
Why?
Well, he was dressed up in women's clothes, and that didn't suit us, really.
He was an indoor boy, and we were outdoor boys. Were we?
Yeah. You see, outdoor boys is rougher and readier than Joe was. Joe wasn't rough and ready anyway. I mean, to us, he was entirely different. I mean, we would be out shooting, fishing, rambling about, whereas Joe'd be up in his little shed up the garden, working with his wirelesses and what have you.
I was about 5 years old when I first wanted a gramophone, and it was one of those toy gramophones with a celluloid sound box and a key to wind it up. Well, and I discovered if you play the record at the end on the run-out groove, you could shout down the sound chamber and the sound would be imprinted in the grooves. And I thought that I'd discovered something marvellous. And of course, I was really doing just what Edison had discovered years before.
You moved to a farm, didn't you,
Me and Joe, Dinmore Hill, that is.
Oh, yes, that was...
Dinmore. I left school, I went to look after that, and when Joe left school, he come up and helped me.
And you, both of you, together looked after the farm on your own?
Yeah.
And what did Joe do? What's his contribution to
that? Well, Joe used to do all the cooking and all the cleaning and feed the cattle and that, you know. He used to muck in, same as me. I used to milk a couple of cows and that, and...
But he was, he had special meals that he would cook for you, didn't he?
Yes, he was a great cook, our Joe, he was a great cook.
And what sort of stuff did he cook?
He was very fond of sausages.
And what was the other thing, wasn't it?
Artichokes in the garden. There was artichokes in the garden when we got there, and Joe liked them. Have you ever tasted artichokes?
No.
No, I have. They're a bit soapy. Like potatoes, only a bit soapy.
And then I went in the forces when I was 18 and became a radar mechanic. And also I was pretty handy around the camp at repairing radios and record players. When I came out, in the meantime my father had died, I decided that I must take the plunge and move to London and take a job connected with recording. And so I came to London and took a job in Stone's radio shop in Edgware Road.
The London that greeted Meek was just emerging from the throes of post-war austerity. His fascination with sound and all things electronic enabled him to get a job at Stone's, one of London's biggest record stores. Musically, the stars of the day were middle-aged and middle of the road. There, he began to establish his first contacts with the recording business, and even began to accumulate his own recording equipment.
Midnight, one more night without sleeping, watching till the morning comes.
He moved into a flat in Notting Hill with a friend he'd met in London called Lionel Howard. Their friendship lasted almost till Meek's death. Meek reserved one room in the flat for a makeshift studio.
Tried to tell
him
I'd been there.
We used to have mics all over the house and record whatever we were saying. Didn't matter who was there. Like, you never knew whether he was being recorded or whether you weren't.
What did he do with those recordings?
He'll play them back to us sometime.
Was that not embarrassing?
Very. Sometimes.
He used to play the music up in the cherry orchard. When the cherry pickers were picking the cherries, Joe would have loudspeakers up in the trees to play the pickers' music. They loved that, didn't they?
Yeah.
Come to the station, jump from the
After various jobs in the recording industry, he landed a job at Lansdowne, a studio that recorded the likes of Joan Regan, Edmund Hockridge and Ann Shelton for the major record companies. Meek was hired as an assistant engineer, but from the word go, he was determined to do things his way. And despite his junior status, he engineered some of the biggest hits of the day, like Green Door and Lay Down Your Arms. What's more, he thought of them as his hits. An
order is an order. Well, now we're on the subject of records, I'd like to play you some of my latest ones that are doing quite well on the market. First of all, we have Ann Shelton with Lay Down Your Arms. I did this recording about a month ago, and we used, for the marching speech, we used a box with gravel in it. This record is going right to the top.
There were no rules about how to get the best sound, as far as he was concerned.
He had a little piece of ex-army equipment in a green box, and we had... It took me a long time to find out what this was, but he made this spring echo device. And it was his secret box with his secret sounds, as he used to say. And he wouldn't tell anybody what he was doing. He used to hitch this box up and just use it in all sorts of ways to process sounds that were going through it, and would keep it locked away. It was all taped up with black tape. You couldn't get near it.
While Meek was at Lansdowne, he recorded many of the top British jazz musicians, Acca Bilk, Chris Barber, and Humphrey Lyttelton.
Go into monumental sulks, because in jazz the general idea is you stick a mic up and you get however many mics, and you get as natural a sound as you possibly can without monkeying about. And Joe over-recorded the drum brushes, Stan Gregg playing the brushes, just normally, just doing a little offbeat and chuck and chuck, and he bumped these up, and he also did something very peculiar in the way of distorting the left hand of the piano. So that octave, rolling octave thing, boom, 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 on the record sounds very, very peculiar indeed. And it's very difficult to play it on a and recapture it on a live thing, because that's not the actual sound that comes out of the piano. And Joe had deliberately distorted the thing. And had I not gone on holiday, and had it been a setup like we have now, where you all gather around and listen to a playback, I would have had a fit. I would have said, that's dreadful. And I would have thrown Joe into one of his sulks, because I would have said that, you know, you've over-recorded the drums and I don't want it. And you've distorted the piano sound and I don't want that either. But in fact, I wasn't there. And so it all came out like that and became a hit, I think, for those reasons. That was a new world for me, that idea of a sound engineer not doing what you tell him, but actually mixing and twiddling the knobs and distorting things. That was a totally new thing to me. By the late 50s, Meek was clear that there was a new audience ready for his kind of music, and a different type of performer ready to play it.
was casual to the nth degree. It was made up on the spot, and everybody was totally surprised when public went out and actually bought these things. I mean, we created a market. This record market did not exist at that point in time. You know, people did not go out, particularly teenagers, up until that time. 14-year-olds were at work. I was at work at 14. We didn't have the kind of money to go out and buy records. So, I mean, teenagers buying records was a whole brand... Teenagers buying anything was a whole brand new market. So the whole thing was like man emerging from the sea. There was no design at all. The big companies made their own recordings, employed their own staff, and hired musicians and singers on a musician's union fee basis. For instance, when I made Rock Island Line, I got £3.10 for singing Rock Island Line. No royalties. There were no royalties then.
Meek soon found the hierarchy of the recording establishment intolerable. He also felt his employers at Lansdowne were unresponsive to his ideas and his songs. After a row, he walked out.
Well, he had a temper. We all got tempers, the Meeks. But Joe lived on a short fuse. But it was over and done with. He'd flare up and then he was back and normal again. But he did have a temper.
Well, I then wrote a song called Put a Ring on Her Finger, which was quite a big hit here and also in America and brought me in quite a lot of money. The difficulty was finding premises to make the recordings because I realised using other independent studios were very expensive. In the end, I found this building in Holloway Road, which gave me three floors. The ground floor is occupied by a leather goods shop, and I decided this was the place for me. I'll describe, first of all, the studio itself. It's on the third floor, and it's the size of an average bedroom, no larger. Now, when I first started recording here, I used to get a lot of leg pulls from these musicians who are top musicians and often are playing in mandolin orchestras, classical orchestras. So they used to come in and they used to look around and they'd say, well, where do you want me? Am I supposed to be in the bathroom?
I'll meet you at your locker when the school's dismissed. I'll carry your books home if you'll just give me one little
This was a complete unit to produce and press the records, and the third record turned out to be a hit. It was Angela Jones by Michael Cox. But this brought on a lot of difficulties because the major record companies decided that they didn't want small operatives, and so they did their best to squash us out of the shops.
Joe Meek was one of the first to actually make product and then lease that to record companies. They reluctantly took it, but he had a style and he had a sound and a certain vision. And of course, he made a path for people like myself who came some 1 or 2 years later. I mean, the hipper people in the industry thought he was, you know, unique, recording at home in his flat and all that sort of stuff. That was something special. I think the industry itself, the record companies and all that, thought probably it was a crank, because they thought anybody that didn't play by the rules were, because they were, record companies were very, very disciplined in terms of the way they went about recording. It wasn't at that time when you worked in a recording studio. I remember you had to wear a collar and a tie and a suit, and the engineers used to wear white jackets like doctors. And I remember a sign up at EMI Studios in Abbey Road where it said sports trousers and jackets maybe weren't worn on Saturdays. that was just the people working in the studios, you know, the engineers. That's how disciplined the whole thing, recording was. They took it all rather seriously. And there's this guy making these records that are selling millions in his kitchen.
How are you, Mr. Gilmore? How are you? My name's Bonnie Davidson, and I look after the boy here. I'm also the leader of the Saints. So if there's anything at all you want, if you need something, you come to me, all right?
Okay. Hello, Mr. Gilmore.
How are you?
I'm Johnny Sincere.
Hello.
I did recognize you. This is Sammy Rivers.
You'll have to excuse me. It's such a long time ago that our memory tends to sort of fade a bit. Had I known we were going to have this interview 30 years ago, I would have paid more attention. I was, as you know, an actor, and I was offered a role on a television series at the time called Harper's West One. And I played the part of a rock and roll star that goes along and opens up the record department in the store.
We're sorry about the hold-up, but we'll be swinging.
We had just recorded Johnny Remember Me. Anyway, I in fact sang the song on the show.
When the mists are rising and the rain is falling and the wind is blowing cold across the moor.
And powers of television, it's straight into the hit parade. Pay presto, I was a pop star.
The girl I loved and lost a year ago. To believe I know, but I hear her singing in the sign of the wind, blowing in the treetops, way above me.
When I recorded Johnny Remember Me, I was in the sitting room. I was in the sitting room behind a little screen, and the rhythm section was in the sitting room with me. The violin section were on the stairs. The backing singers were practically in the loo. And the brass section were underneath, on another floor altogether. And then there was Joe next door, playing his machine like a musical instrument, really. Quite bizarre, isn't it? It really was.
Yes, I'll always remember till the day I die.
Rising and the rain is falling, the wind is blowing cold across the moor. I hear the voice of my darling, the girl I loved and lost a year ago. Went to number one. I telephoned Joe from the phone box on Paddington Station and asked him if there was anything going, anything happening. And he said, we're looking for a song for John Layton, who's going to appear in a series on the television. He said, if you can come up with something by Monday, he said, you might use it. So I went home and woke up on the Sunday and wrote Johnny Remember Me in 10 minutes.
Johnny Remember Me was one of the classic examples of the eerie Joe Meek sound. Both he and Goddard felt that their inspiration might have come from beyond the grave.
I used to play Holly's records every day of the week. And Joe Meek also was obsessed with Buddy Holly.
Yes, he always had an interest in the occult. You know, we had visits from Buddy Holly last night, and the fact that Buddy Holly was coming to visit him and talking to him and helping him with guidance.
And we were holding this seance at his flat in Holloway Road, fingers on the tumbler, goes round to the letters on the table. And we asked, would Johnny Remember Me be a hit? And it spelt out that it would go to number one. And then we asked if the tribute that I'd written to Buddy Holly would be a hit. And it answered, see you in the charts.
We'll always remember
Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly was killed in a plane crash in 1959. But his songs will always be remembered. Always.
I used to know that Joe Meek. Well, I was amazed because I had the address and I pulled up with my hearse at the time with the coffin in the back and pulled it out and I was looking for it, I think, because he was macabre and liked horror stuff. And it's all I could find was this leather shop. And Mrs. Shelton, I couldn't believe it. It was just above that. And so I asked him there, so he lives above. And then when I went up these rickety stairs, I couldn't believe this where all these number one records come from, you know.
Eyes are red, I laugh like gurgling water.
Is that the lover you want to give?
Yes.
Well, yeah. Oh, fair enough. Right. It's a bit over the top. Okay. Well, went a bit weird that time.
Yeah, well,
I did notice that he was always asking members of my band to stay over after we'd done 2 or 3 hours in the studio to do a bit of overdubbing. I think he called it overdubbing. But they said, oh, I'm not going up there again on my own, you know. But it was always, I noticed, I was very naive. He was never the ugly ones in the band, you know. He was never the ugly sax player or the drummer without any teeth.
I think now it would be a good idea if I describe a rather typical day in my life. It starts about 9:30, the phone begins to ring merrily away, and as a rule, most days I have some form of recording to do. We'll say, today I'm going to make a record with a new artist. It's been brought round to me and I feel has potential. I've auditioned him and he has a different sounding voice, and I feel has the sort of looks that could appeal to the public.
This is our friend Telstar. If you were with us earlier this evening, you know what this is. If you weren't, let me say very quickly, it is the near miracle satellite now in orbit in space, some hiding coyly somewhere behind the horizon, which we hope in just 1 hour from now, during this very program, is going to transmit to us the first ever live public television pictures from the United States of America.